Welcome to the Hero Escape Podcast, your weekly escape from your padded cell at Arkham Asylum. I am one of your three co-hosts, Hingle McCringleberry, and I am joined by...
Maggie Gyllenhaal, but not that one.
And I am Peter Panic, but you may call me Francois.
Nice. Francois.
Yeah, Francois. So, welcome to another episode of Hero Escape. We are excited for you to escape with us. Today, we're going to do something a little bit different. In the past, we've talked about some of our favorite comic book or superhero characters, mainly focusing on heroes. Today, we want to highlight one of the greatest all-time villains of all time. And he's got to be in everybody's top list. When you think super villain, you think eventually, soon, high on your list is going to be
Ryan
the
Johnson.
One.
Oh, no, sorry.
The one, the only, the Joker. So, he's been, as long as there's been comic books, there's been the Joker, essentially. We want to dive into why he's an awesome character, why he's been basically timeless and classic, and why he is such a super villain. Nathaniel, take us out, man.
I'm the DC nut. Mm-hmm. And if we're going to do the Joker, we're going to go deep.
Oh, going down that rabbit hole, everybody.
If everyone would bear with me, this will all tie together. But if you're going to go to the true origin of the Joker, you're going to go back to the original creators, Bob Kane, Bill Finger, and where they got their inspiration.
Is this the 50s?
40s.
Oh, it goes way further than that.
Oh, man.
1940.
Really? So they were like on
the
bomber
side. Deeper than that, even.
Oh, man.
Before that, yeah.
Join me, audience and co-hosts, as we travel way, way back to April of 1869.
What?
Wow.
When famed author Victor Hugo wrote a novel with the French title L'Homme qui rit, which means the man who laughs.
So that's why you can call me Francois.
This is where it all really began, because no art is truly out of the blue. I think every artist ultimately would cop to the fact that there are little inspirations that met them along the road that eventually culminated into something. So if we're going to touch the Joker, we got to go way back to where this began. So here's the synopsis for that novel. In late 17th century England, a homeless boy named Gwynplaine rescues an infant girl during a snowstorm, her mother having frozen to death while feeding her. They meet an itinerant carnival vendor who calls himself Ursus, and his pet wolf, Homo. That's the name. What do you want? Gwynplaine's mouth
so not PC.
Has been mutilated into a perpetual grin. Ursus is initially horrified, then moved to pity, and he takes them in. 15 years later, Gwynplaine has grown into a strong young man, attractive except for his distorted visage. And the girl has also grown up, but she's blind. By touching his face, she concludes that Gwynplaine is perpetually happy, and they fall in love. And then through a series of events, it comes out that he was actually sold when he was a child to essentially this evil group who was known for kidnapping, mutilating children, and then selling them to freak shows and circuses and things like that. So it's a little bit of a Count of Monte Cristo-esque, you know, he gets his comeuppance, that sort of thing. So this novel is really the beginnings of the path that leads us to the Joker. And I personally, at least, found it fascinating that it went back that far.
So, like, the comic book artists, they cite that, and they talk about, like, this we drew from that kind of a thing?
Well, that was April 1869.
Mm-hmm.
On November 4th, 1928, Universal Studios adapted into a movie, mm-hmm. The Man Who Laughs, starring an actor named Conrad Veidt. And if you pull up a picture on Google of Conrad Veidt in that film, you will instantaneously recognize the way that they made him up to be the Gwynplaine character. The stretched smile is there, the pale skin, the slick back hair is all there.
Wow.
It is unmistakably the Joker before the Joker. So fast forward a little bit after that to a date that all true Batman fans know. May
1939. Date Detective dear to our Comics, hearts.
Number 27. The first appearance of Batman. Thus the legend was born. Later on that same year, though, Bob Kane, the famous creator of Batman, hired a 17-year-old kid, Jerry Robinson, after he saw Robinson in a white jacket decorated with his own illustrations. Robinson quickly became the primary artist for the newly created Batman comic book series. So this guy shows up right when Batman is brand new. And as Detective Comics, you know, sort of Batman was exploded into Detective Comics, right?
Yeah.
Usually they're doing these little featurettes and people are like, we want more of that guy for obvious reasons.
Because he's Batman.
So they decide, hey, we're going to do Batman number one. But if we're going to do that, we need an iconic villain to kick this off. So in an interview with Robinson, he said, I wanted somebody visually exciting. I wanted somebody that would make an indelible impression, would be bizarre, would be memorable, like the Hunchback of Notre Dame or any other villains that had unique physical characteristics. So he drew up some sketches of basically Joker playing cards, like the traditional jester representation.
Right.
And he said, in that first meeting, when I showed them that sketch of the Joker, Bill Finger said it reminded him of Conrad Veidt in The Man Who Laughs.
Da-da-da-da.
That is what brought together the loose concept of, hey, let's have this jester villain who's sort of evil, but he's laughing all the time. And the visual that has persisted all the way through today of this sort of eerily huge grin stretched out over the face.
Yeah, that's like the classic. Any comic that he's on the cover of depicted, it's always this impossibly huge, wicked grin, right? That's iconic.
I'm trying to think if there's been a version that I think of that hasn't had that. And you know what? I can think of one version of the Joker I think that didn't really have that. Maybe I'm wrong. The Suicide Squad version, he didn't have that huge smile. He would smile big on purpose sometimes, but he didn't.
You mean the film, or are you talking about
the film, the movies that came out last year, 2 years ago, something like that. I don't think he had that. So
he smiled more than was like, it was unnerving still, but it was less than the grotesquely huge. Yeah.
He could relax his face into a normal pose.
Yeah. Yeah. Anyway. The grills, the dental grills.
Yeah, he had those.
Yeah. So that's really the true lineage in my mind as a huge Batman fan and undoubtedly a Joker fan.
Now the villain lore.
That's the trail that brought him about. Well, and then in the spring of 1940, Batman number one.
Yeah. I mean, a lot of villains and literature or mythology, you know, have their roots somewhere. And that is really interesting. I'm pulling up these images as you're talking and you're right. It is definitely spot on. Undeniably, you're onto it there for sure.
Absolutely. So another interesting little tidbit from the early years that I found out. I would have guessed, and I don't know if you guys would be the same, but before looking at this, I would have guessed that the Joker started out as the silly prankster, as the 1966-esque Joker, as this sort of silly guy. But when he initially was introduced, they introduced him as a psychotic serial killer, you know, that was killing them with the Joker venom and the toxin would leave them with the stretched smile and all that. That was all in place from the beginning. That was the original inception.
He was a murderer in the 40s. I mean, he was doing that and stuff in the 40s?
Yeah.
Because at that time, the comic books were, I guess you could argue that they were geared towards a slightly older audience. They weren't thinking we're trying to shuffle these to little kids. It wasn't the comic strips and the funny papers. You know, it wasn't that same demographic they were shooting for.
I didn't know that.
Yeah,
I think even there's one of the original covers, right, is considered very highly sought after of one of the Batman comics where he pops out and he has a gun in each hand.
Yeah,
one pointed at Batman, one pointed at Robin, which a lot of the comics tried to shy away from using actual guns, but they weren't. He's very serious, and he's a murderer.
Yeah, there was a time where they're like, no guns. Yeah. So, you know, Batman that's never used a gun. And
came up with all this sort of sci-fi, you know, freeze guns and different sort of silly weapons. But
yeah.
Wow.
Another interesting deep cut I found in the midst of all this was that he was originally intended to be killed in his second appearance in Batman number one. He was going to get stabbed in the heart because the creators thought if he doesn't die, it's going to make Batman look weak, which I find fascinating given the current controversy about Batman killing or not and how it's become so iconic. So back then, another change both in Batman and Joker that they were just like, well, we have to kill him off. Yeah, he'll be a cool villain. But then editor overruled it and they were like, okay, how are we going to rectify this? So they hastily drew a final panel in a comic book that showed he was still alive and the rest is history. So,
wow.
I thought that's pretty rad.
Escaping death already in issue two.
And he appeared in 9 of the first 12 issues of Batman. That's how sort of immediate his iconic status was.
Well, that explains why Joker is like synonymous with Batman. You know, can't separate them.
Really. When you think of Batman, I think your next thought is probably the Joker. Yeah. And then maybe you start thinking of Robin and Batgirl and different. But I think next thought is
absolutely
Joker.
It highlights really in a huge way that right from the beginning, Batman in many ways, like it or not, was defined by his villains. Like, you know what I mean?
Yeah, he's got the best villains. And one of the things I've always liked about Joker is it's easy to like the Joker in all the various iterations. You've got tons of comics here in our recording studio, and there's plenty of iterations of him in movies and video games, all these different iterations of the Joker. And they're all a little bit different. But he's not one of those characters, for some reason, if they make him different, that it really bothers you that much, because Joker at his core is anarchy. He is insane. So as long as you have the guy being sick and twisted and insane, it fits Joker, right? And
as long as he has some of those key elements, because there is a version or two I do not like, because I feel like they leave those things out. But as long as he has these certain
he's
characteristics of the Joker, then they can kind of
do whatever. Yeah, he's just got to be insane. You know, you want the certain look needs to fit, right? And it's as long as it's twisted, it fits. And so even though there's been a bazillion iterations of him, you still eat him up. You still like it, right? Because I think it still fits. And I think that's also one of the things that makes him have staying power is that the current societal norm of what's sick and twisted might change. But as long as you make him sick and twisted, he's relevant to the present audience.
Yeah. Yeah.
Right? So I think that, you know, what was considered sick and twisted in the 1700s or versus, you know, back when Pow, Zam, and Kaplowy days, you know, Batman with Cesar Romero playing it, or Dark Knight or Arkham Asylum, he's messed up in all of those, right? And so we all like, yep, that's the Joker. He's got a messed up smile and he's doing all those things.
Yeah.
What are some of those other things to you guys that make him so
iconic? Historically, the Golden Age was defined by a lot of regulations on the comic book industry as it emerged and sort of began to build out into a proper industry. And part of that was a mandate down from the top that you have to tone down the Joker's sort of homicidal serial killer ass side. And that
creeping people out a little bit.
The silly prankster Joker, you know, the guy that's not a threat on that same level. And that went on for many, many years. I would argue right up into the 70s. So,
which explains the TV, like, which defined Batman for a generation. The Kaplowy, I call it the Kaplowy. Yeah, 1966. The Pow, Zap, Kaplowy, with the Cesar Romero playing it, where it was so ridiculous and over the top. Even today, I cannot put on those episodes and not be entertained. It's there's all the actors. They've got top of the line actors doing this show, running around in pajamas and with the most absurd concoctions. You know, same bat time, same bat channel to find out if Batman escapes this absurd swinging axe that Joker left him tied to. Right.
Yeah.
I mean, that's there's people still spoof off today. Right. But they're so all into it that I can't help but be entertained. If you've never watched any of those episodes, fans, do yourself a favor and watch them. They're so hilariously cheesy. It's like if you went and were sitting on a campfire with a bunch of friends, you decided to put on some skits, but you happened to have like excellent costumes to wear. excellently terrible costumes to wear. Like, this is the type of skit you would do with these episodes, right? And like Batman, the movie that came out in the late '60s, like he's trying to get rid of this bomb and he's running all over the docks trying to get it. He can't throw it here because people walk by. Someone on a bike is over here. He goes to the dock and there's a duck there. So he can't throw it there. He's like, oh, some days you just can't get rid of a bomb. Like that's an actual line from a movie. And it's so cheesy because, you know, Joker and Penguin and everybody's have teamed up and, you know, it's really bad.
The writing was top notch.
Yes, yeah. Yes, yes. So where it's so goofy and campy, but then you go forward to some more modern day ones and you see 1989, Michael Keaton and the very famous Jack Nicholson Batman, who he got I was reading it, he got paid because he took less money than he normally took to play that role, but he said, I want a piece of the take from the ticket sales. Word on the street is Jack Nicholson got paid over $60 million.
Really?
To play
Who's
the Joker.
Who's laughing that?
Yeah, yeah. Yes.
Which has one of my all-time, what kind of a world is this where a man dressed as a bat steals all my press? This town needs an enema. That was my line, like in teenagers, I would say, this town needs an enema. First I had to figure out what that meant, but then I used it all the time. Yeah. But that Batman, like, defined crazy for a generation. There was the campy Joker generation. Yeah. Then there was the more Jack Nicholson, an amazing actor, nominated for Academy Awards, like more than any other dude. No, like people really thought after Who Flew Over the Cuckoo's Nest, or that movie, people really thought he was dangerously insane. Like that's how convincing he was as a crazy guy. But that version of Joker, that defined Joker for a long time. And to me, that was the definitive representation of Joker until.
Before you go there. So I felt the same way. Now, if I go back, it is hard for me to watch the Jack Nicholson version because it feels almost more to me now closer to the Kaplowy 1960s version.
It is.
It feels
that's
like
that's where
that
I'm
now.
Going for.
So there's a whole dumb scene where he's dancing through a museum and painting art.
Yes,
and you're like, this
yes.
is ridiculous.
Yeah.
Like that.
So I watched.
He's like
recently.
Dad dancing through
like they've been killing people and doing all these horrible things, but he comes with his gang of guys and they open up their
dancing
mind,
to
expand,
this.
We're going to expand our minds tonight. And it's all part of destroying, defaming Gotham plus capturing, Vicky Vale and trying to seduce Vicky Vale. That's what it's all about.
But he did for the time up the.
Insane.
The sinisterness of the Joker for the time.
For me.
Well, it's important to note that that didn't happen totally out of a vacuum either. That was the culmination of this shift that was happening in the comic books too.
Mm-hmm.
That brought them to a more serious tone because they went through those years of the silly Joker.
Kaplowy.
Yeah. Yeah. And then in 73, a storyline comes out. The 70s sort of began for a lot of comics. Like things started getting darker and grittier.
Mm-hmm.
And. There was a story came out called The Joker's Five-Way Revenge, where suddenly he's back being on his homicidal, maniacal self. And that sort of started a tilt back. And then the late 80s, I didn't realize this until I reviewed the dates, but the late 80s is when most of the iconic Joker stories came out within a very short space of time. Some of them very dark.
What years? Well, do you have the one? When did he kill Jason Todd? Was that early
88 to 89? Death in the Family was the story arc where he kills Jason Todd, and they were having an issue where Jason Todd was not a very popular Robin.
Yeah.
So they put it up to a vote. They let the fans like vote on how is this going to come out, and they voted for the Joker killing Jason Todd with a crowbar, as he did. In that very famous.
Yeah. Which is, and that's a dark storyline, right? I mean, he was a teenager and Joker kidnaps him.
So that explains why they felt, or that had to have fed into the 89 release with Michael Keaton and Jack Nicholson.
Oh, yeah.
Because that was a dark, that's clearly a dark storyline you just described. But to my knowledge, I would declare that as the first real attempt to make a superhero movie be like serious and intense. Like there was, the goofs. I mean, it was a PG-13 movie. It wasn't like, you know, rated R or something like that, but it was, they were trying to make this not campy. They were trying to turn the page. Superhero movie. We're going to make a superhero movie and it's going to be seriously awesome.
Yeah. They wanted
and
you to start taking
it
serious.
And they hit it out of the park, by the way. I mean, people loved it. I mean, totally loved it. And Joker, having just again watched that movie in preparation for this episode, Joker really is the star of that movie. The movie's called Batman. Jack Nicholson has way more lines and way more screen time than Batman himself in that movie.
Tim Burton knew what he was doing. I think that he was the right man for the job at that time.
And so you see, just to your guys, with the points you're making, Jack Nicholson is a perfect transition from what the people would have, their iconic version going into that would have been the old goofy, kaplowy Joker, and he transitions it to this really sick, twisted one, which then the next major iteration of the Joker isn't even attempted for several decades until the Dark Knight trilogy comes out.
Yeah.
And Heath Ledger then gets the role to the surprise of everyone out of nowhere. Like, what? What? Heath Ledger? Why are they giving that role? I mean, who would have thought? I would have never picked him.
I remember I didn't get to see that movie right away for a while. It was out for a while before
really?
I
could see you
it.
Didn't see
Yeah, I Dark didn't. Knight? I don't remember what if I was out of town or something, but I remember talking to friends saying, have you seen it yet? And I remember thinking, like, can this guy be the Joker? That was a big deal. And a friend of mine, and I saw him at the store, I think, and I'd planned to go see it like that night or the next night or something. And I was like, so how does he do as the Joker? What's going on? He's like, I did not think that he could do this, but he is, it's amazing. He's like, I didn't think he could be, he said, I didn't think he could be better than Jack Nicholson version, but he knocks out.
Holy cow.
It's incredible.
Yeah. And I have to, whenever I watch that movie now, I think, I mean, so much money and effort goes into making the movie good, period. But with the passing of Heath Ledger, I feel like every scene he's in, every syllable he utters, was digitally, cinematographically mastered. Like the way his voice sounds is they mastered all of it. Like I'm sure his performance was amazing, but I think everything went into making that be as awesome as possible for the movie's own sake, but also probably because they wanted to do him justice, right? And man, you're right. Hit it all apart. So to me, that movie with starring the Joker, honestly, more interesting, more lines, and probably more screen time than Christian Bale again. All right. And that movie to me has to be in everybody's top three all time superhero movies. If it's not, I don't want you, you're not even a person. Okay. Yeah. Stop. You're not even made out of carbon atoms. Okay. Because now it is awesome. I can't watch that movie too frequently because I think it ages me a couple years every time I watch it because it's so freaking intense.
Yeah.
And it's so intense because of how awesome the Joker is, because what the Joker always is this suicidal, maniacal, but in The Dark Knight, he's not only a self-belief that I enjoy suicide, anarchy, and all the crazy stuff. He believes that everybody has that monster inside him, and it's a lie that they try to cover it up, and he wants to make everybody go crazy with him.
All you need is a little push.
Yeah, that's what, and that to me is even more messed up, right? And so Joker makes that movie because he's full of idiosyncrasies and hypocrisies. Like, remember when he's willing to put the gun, a loaded gun, to his head with Two-Face in the bed, right? Yeah. He's like, I'm like a dog chasing a car. I wouldn't even know what to do if I got it, right? I'm not, those guys are schemers, right? Yeah. But that's baloney. There's no ways he could be doing what he's doing in this movie without being a schemer. But here he is putting a gun to his head for a flip of a coin because he's just that crazy. And he wants to make sure Harvey Dent goes full crazy.
Yeah.
And it's that important to him.
Yeah.
Let me take you to that scene with the boats, right? This is only the Joker can do this. I've never seen any other villain do this. He has the two boats, right? The two barges trying to escape Gotham. One's full of prisoners from Arkham Penitentiary. Right. One's full of regular Joes. They both have the detonator to blow up the other boat.
Just for the other DC nerds, Blackgate, but carry on.
Yeah.
Blackgate.
Blackgate Prison.
Penitentiary.
Oh, sorry. My bad. Thank you.
The slightly less crazy criminals are in Blackgate.
Yeah, not Arkham Asylum. Okay. So remember this now. And Joker's going to blow them both up unless the one blows up the other.
Right.
Right? And
I think, did he say he'll blow them both up at midnight if they don't choose first or something like that?
Yeah, I mean, he's, so, and you feel that, and I'm watching this movie, and oh my gosh, Christopher Nolan, we trust, right? Like, he's doing such a good job in the making of this, when it comes to making movies, I'm not committing blasphemy, but okay. And I'm watching that, and I know how the movie ends, and I'm still like getting white knuckle clenched, like, oh my gosh. And you see the looks like, are they gonna do it?
Yeah.
So that is the sickness of the Joker, is that he's not content leaving it to himself. He wants it to spread, right? He's trying to spread this love of anarchy of the soul to people, and he's trying to, cause whoever turns the key and blows up to the other, first of all, that act itself is disgusting, but he's completely tortured the minds of the souls of those people who did it. They're going to be eating up that shouldn't I or should, of course I did. He's putting them in a mental torment the rest of their lives if they turn that key, you know, to push the bomb to blow up the other people. And that's what he's feeding off of, which is so sick, right?
Well, that's the culmination in that movie of the philosophical fight that he's in with Batman, which is Batman's premise is the Gothamites are good at their core. They are basically good.
Yes.
And the Joker is contesting that through all of his various schemes.
Which he refuses to learn. Oh, they just need another push and I'm going to blow one of them up and I'm going to make them crazy anyway. And Batman's like, these people just proved to you by not blowing each other up that there is still good.
And that could have been, that's the brilliance of the movie, is that could have been your end point. It could have been, okay, Batman just won. His ideology won. But then it moves into the Two-Face arc and that coming to an end. Where Batman's ideology is crushed.
And shows Joker won. He corrupted the White Knight.
Yeah. Which is, again, multiple layers. So beautifully done.
It's, yes.
Yeah, if you haven't watched that movie, The Dark Knight, do yourself a favor and watch it.
Yeah. Yes. Yeah. Yes.
I watch it with my wife, who has less than zero interest in any of these superhero films and everything. And even she, you know, was.
Yeah.
Totally into it.
Cause
it's so compelling.
What the Joker realized, I was trying to crystallize how to put it into words in that movie further, is he shows you, and why I'm like panting in sweat when it's all done, he shows you how frail a civilized society actually is. Now, Joker thinks it's all a lie that there's quote unquote such a thing as civilized society, but you know, we are all at each other's mercy if we just lose our couple of screws in our dome, right? We really can, which unfortunately is, you know, the news today. But anyway, so it's a intense tense. And that's what Joker, I think, is why he sticks around since hundreds of, you know, in his different iterations. The true inner demon of our own insanity, of relishing in insanity, that any human has that demon inside of him. And I think that's why he registers.
Is that your favorite variation of the Joker than the Heath Ledger? Or do you have one you like better than?
Yeah. I mean, like I said, I can watch other hero movies often and enjoy them. I can't watch that one all that often because it takes a couple of years out of my life, but that is the best iteration of the Joker for me, hands down.
I think it's clear from how effusive and excited you got the instant you started talking about
it,
which I'm right there with you, man. That movie is amazing. And I think everybody agrees that it's the culmination.
I said everyone else has to have it in their top three. To me, it's the best. It was not what I call the most fun, but it's definitely
in my top for sure. Yeah. And I will say that I don't think that's my favorite iteration of the Joker, but he's probably he's up there. Yeah.
Now you got to back that up. Oh, well,
now you got to say, David, what is my favorite come at me, bro. Yeah. Come at me, bro. What's your
So, my favorite iteration of the Joker is, the Mark Hamill iteration of the Joker, I think.
He did the animated series.
Well, he did the animated series and he also voices him in all of the Arkham games except Arkham Origin, which a different studio did, but he does Arkham Asylum, Arkham City, and Arkham Knight. And I just really love, I don't know that Mark Hamill wrote all the Joker's lines and the character in there, but the writing and his a personification of the Joker. I love it because he's this character that is loonier, I would say, a little crazier in a silly way than the Heath Ledger version. And I think that's funny because there's times he does it so well because there's times when he is funny and for a second you're like, this guy's kind of cool. I like this guy. And then he will immediately say something that is terrible and you're, oh, that's right. This guy is a murderer and a psychopath
and a
monster. He's disgusting. He's a monster. I have to remember that, but he will have these lines in there where I should have written some down, but he'll say something that'll have you just like kind of laughing, thinking, oh, that's funny, you know, he's, and then immediately, or very soon later on, you're, oh, that's right, this guy's awful.
He's disgusting. I don't want to touch him.
But to be able to do that is tricky, right? I don't know if I have the skill or the mastery to be able to go from one end of the spectrum, likable, to a monster very quickly.
Yeah. Which speaks to the character of Joker as well as the range of Mark Hamill.
Yes.
And for those of you listening, Mark, and the we good do writing mean of the same Mark Hamill who acts as Luke Skywalker. Those who don't know this, he has been doing the voice for the Joker for like decades, right? In various cartoons and now those videos.
I think it was 90s when they started that Batman animated series again. And Mark Hamill does a great job, and it's similar. It's just the artwork is different, but similar, I would say, in tone that the Joker's kind of crazy and sort of charismatic at times. And
Batman in the animated series is what gave birth to my love of Batman. Yeah.
I think that's true for a lot of people.
That show up. Paul Dini, who was instrumental in that entire show, the creator, was a genius on so many levels because he innovated in so many areas. The dark tones that he chose to use, almost everything has a black background, and then they're bringing other colors out in it. He is the one who conceived of and introduced Harley Quinn.
Yeah,
really.
Joker's quasi,
which adds a wrinkle in depth to the Joker character.
Exactly, because their relationship is. It works so well because it is an extension of him. It is not, you wouldn't watch them in any portrayal and say that that's a romantic relationship. But at the same time, it's undeniably what their version of a romantic relationship would be.
Yeah. She's like an acolyte fangirl of him that they get romantically involved.
Yeah. Right?
So, and she was originally like his psychotherapist, but warps Dr. her.
Harlene Quinzel.
Yes. Yeah. He warps her and keeps taking her further and further down the insane Joker rabbit hole. And they become, you know, this tandem, which is we've seen them paired up and that relationship portrayed in the most recent cinematic release of a live action Joker in the Suicide Squad.
Yeah.
And I think they kind of get they get the Joker wrong. I don't want to blame Jared Leto for it, but
I didn't hate their version of the Harley Quinn. I didn't.
Right. Right. Classic Harley Quinn. Their relationship seemed right. I think they kind of got the abusive, crazy relationship.
If the Joker had been a little bit more towards the animated series Joker in whatever way, it would have felt like
it would have been better.
Instead of more like a crime boss or whatever.
I think none of us picked the Jared Leto version of Joker as our favorite. And I think, to me, Jared Leto's a talented actor as far as I know. I'm a good guy. I don't have any beefs with him personally. But that portrayal that they had him do or that he chose to do, it felt like it didn't – It just didn't feel like the Joker.
They tried to make him more of this cool guy, like a crime club boss, owner, crime boss club,
which
like
Joker
a mafia.
Does not care about that
which
stuff.
I thought, yeah, he does not care about. He does not care about making money.
He doesn't even care about personal hygiene, for goodness sakes. What does he care about? You know what I'm saying? Like,
what I found fascinating is that despite the fact that the vast majority of moviegoers did not like his portrayal, he did not receive anywhere near the level of hate that some other people have, like Batfleck and things, because I think every single human being was on the same page as far as nobody can follow Heath Ledger. I don't envy him in his task, and it's almost like everyone's expectations were so low, like it's impossible.
Yeah.
So
he couldn't,
good luck.
He couldn't do Heath Ledger, so he had to do something different, and anything different wasn't going to be as good, right? Yeah, so he was kind of impossible.
He was kind of just a side character to the movie. I think if they tried to make him that Batman, the main, I think he probably would have got a decent amount of hate from it, but as a side character, I think people were like, the whole movie was not great, so it was just one bad thing.
Okay, so, we've kind of been professing our fanboy love for, I know we don't love villains here, but where do we
speak for yourself, my friend?
The dark side is strong with you, Nathaniel. Okay, so where would you guys put Joker on your all-time top list of villains? Where do you put Joker, Dave?
It's a tough call, I guess. I don't normally rank my villains, but I would say he is, and I would say a large part in thanks. I've recently been playing all the Arkham games again, and they're so good if you like video games and you like Batman. Play the Arkham Knight, is amazing.
Mark Hamill does the voice.
Right? Mark Hamill does the voice on that one, and that's his best one, I think. So yeah, if you haven't played it, go play it because it's awesome.
It's a PS4, Xbox.
I think it's on all of them. Yeah, PC, PS4 for sure. Probably on Xbox. I have a PlayStation.
Okay, sorry. Uncle Owen, Batman keeps beating me up. Yeah.
He's definitely top five. I put him in top five for sure.
Okay.
Definitely top five.
He's in my top one.
Top one, really? Wow.
That's a very limited space up there.
It's a rarefied air. Okay.
Yeah, I mean, it depends on the iteration of him. But I think that after Heath Ledger sort of cemented that.
The Martha Wayne iteration, is that the one you want?
Yeah, totally. Mm-hmm. I just, it's a little bit like what you said, his elasticity, his ability to endure over time and decades. Mm-hmm. I just feel like he's so unpredictable, and I feel like he has endured because he's unlike other villains. He doesn't show up with an agenda.
Other than to make people messed up.
Yeah. Even one of the great villains, you know, Darth Vader, he's got sort of an agenda that's clear cut, whereas the Joker is just, you never know where he's coming from.
Mm-hmm. You know what I think makes him, if I can interject real quick, I think one of the things that makes him so interesting is that in a lot of the Arkham series, and Arkham series does this, and so does some of the comic series, it's that in a way, he loves Batman. In a way, he feels like this is a game between him personally and Batman, and he wants this to go on forever. I will do something crazy, and you come and stop me, or we will see who wins, and this is going to be, to him, it's fun, right?
Yeah, which, and the Lego Batman Lego movie, he plays off that. And then you guys got me to read the book series, Death of the Family, where Joker kind of comes back, wears the skin of his face that had been peeled off months before, straps it back onto his face, and does all sorts of really messed up stuff. Do not let your kids see that comic book. But anyways, it is pretty messed up. But yeah, you're totally right. Absolutely. Yeah.
He's this villain, arch villain, whatever, but that also loves the guy that he should be, you know, like that.
Codependent. Cause at the end of that series, he'd rather essentially kills himself rather than have Batman break the game by figuring out who Joker is, or Joker doesn't want to know who Batman is because it ruins the fun of the insanity he's trying to create. He loves the game so much.
Famous storyline too, where he shoots, Batgirl in the takes her in the spine and she can't walk anymore. And I think he leaves a writing on the wall of something like, this is what happens when you involve your friends in this game between us. Like, this is between you and me. This is fun for us. Don't involve other people. But that's how he.
Okay. Well, for me, I think he's got to be, man. If the Heath Ledger version of the Joker for me, man, I'm thinking it's got to be in top three. Yeah. I mean, he's top five, bottom at the worst. I mean, it's very, 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 very good. Very, very good. So yeah, very good.
As the Star Wars fan, is your number one somebody from the Star Wars universe? I was just making sure.
Okay. All right. Well, that's a good topic. Let's go into everybody's favorite wrap-up skit. No, it's not a skit. What's it called again?
It's our favorite segment.
Would win. All right. So those of you still tuned in, we're going to have some fun today. We've randomly selected two of amazing combatants for who would win. David, who's our first one again?
Our first one is one of my faves of the heroes, Captain America.
Steve Rogers, Captain America.
There's multiple versions. So
yeah. Other versions are retarded. We're just Steve Rogers.
Great always.
Yeah. There you go.
Steve Rogers is Captain America. All other versions of Captain America are the same as children dressing up at Halloween. You can pretend, but you're not Captain America.
Okay. All right. Who is the great Cap going up against?
He is going up against Boba Fett.
The one and the Star only Wars favorites. The greatest smuggler in the galaxy.
So.
Oh, man.
Most people should know Captain America pretty well. He's
I don't think we need to
awesome at everything. We don't need to describe whatever he does. Got the shield.
Really handsome.
Yeah. Okay. And handsome. If that helps him in the fight somehow.
Handsome. We don't know behind that helmet.
You don't know. He could be handsome. He looks, well, I guess we know exactly what he looks like, his clone father, right? Okay, so Boba Fett's got definitely more accoutrements.
So Boba Fett doesn't have any real powers. He just has
a jetpack, a missile, he's got a blowtorch, a
flamethrower, dart, a rifle dart. Yeah, knee pads.
That is one of his
Dude, weapons.
You know, I'm gonna have to rethink my vote on this one with the knee pads.
Got those knee pads there. So, wrist laser, concussion grenade thrower, carbine rifle.
Okay, so he's a well-armed combatant. I think, probably, well, but Cap has the super soldier serum.
He does have the super soldier serum.
All his pectorals and things like that. And, yeah. And he's got the vibranium shield. Come on, that scene when he comes out of the chamber, psh, in First Avenger, and like Carter's like, gotta touch his pecs. Yeah. Okay. Anyways.
Man, so let me say,
way to make it awkward.
Boba Fett is awesome, but you just, in this fight, you just gotta, how quickly, it comes into how quickly does Captain America take him down? Is it less than a minute? Can Captain America get it down?
The speed rate of the shield flying to the air.
How fast is that?
When Captain America throws his mighty shield.
I feel like, honestly, I love Boba Fett. Okay, so might be mad at me, but I feel like it's.
Does Boba Fett have anything that can get past the shield?
I don't think he has anything that can get past the shield. Well, if he doesn't, he have lightsabers. I think Boba Fett has a lightsaber too. He's confiscated, right? But I don't know. Does he not have a lightsaber?
Maybe in
too?
Random story arcs, but not like traditional Boba Fett.
So I say, unless he has a lightsaber, he has nothing that can get past.
Well, even the lightsaber, I say, wouldn't cut through the vibranium. That's my personal.
That's the thing. It's all about the shield because, Captain America, for all his strength, is not necessarily bulletproof or blaster proof in this case. So if he was able to hit Captain America with a shot, it's a potential game over. But with the shield in play,
sure. But if Winter Soldier couldn't get him with a potential shot at short distance, he's gonna, you know what I mean?
Yeah.
Captain America knows how to use that shield.
Yeah.
All that junk in that shield trunk. What?
The shield has a trunk? Wow, that shield keeps having more cool stuff about it.
Power creep, right?
Yeah, power creep. Oh, great.
So Nathaniel, where do you give it to?
Yeah, it's gotta be Cap. I can't see this again, unless somehow Blaster Shot got through. That I don't see a scenario where Boba Fett comes out on top. Okay. Much as I love Boba Fett,
yeah. I mean, I could see Boba Fett fighting dirty, having. I mean, he could cut him. He could maybe make Captain America bleed. He could hurt him, but I think if I'm playing the action figure battle, 9 times out of 10, Captain America comes on top. Now, could Boba Fett commit some crime and get away from? Captain America.
I don't think he can get away from Captain America. I would say this let's go without the shield. Without the shield, does Boba Fett take Captain America? Here's what I'm going to say.
I think he could have his way with him. Yeah. I mean, he's got to be able, all those blasters. And I mean, what can he do? He's got to have something to.
I think without the shield brings it down to a maybe 60-40 for Captain America.
Well, it depends on setting. Boba Fett's a flamethrower. What do you
Captain gonna do? America stands the shield, but they're close to the Sarlacc pit.
Trip.
Okay, so it's unanimous. We're giving Captain America the win, the mighty, mighty win, the first Avenger.
Mm-hmm. And we forgot to say this, but if you're looking for some more and kind of some different Joker adaptation, animated movie coming out.
Oh
soon.
Yeah, let's tease. So, Batman we want to talk. Yes, there's an upcoming movie April this year,
April 24th.
It's a very exciting take, a new take. If you can find the trailer, it's they've taken Batman to feudal Japan, right?
So and the Joker, Batman
and the Joker.
A lot of the main characters, the Batman squad, the Joker squad, have all found themselves transported to feudal Japan.
So that's like samurai stuff, and the artwork. Looks amazing. Coming out in a couple months.
April 24th.
All right. Thanks for tuning in. We'll be seeing you guys next week.
See ya.